There was no reason for any of the people of Shoreland, or of the Lost Peninsula, or of West Toledo, to think that the balmy, almost summer day of Sunday would lead to this havoc. Winter had been a long time dying. The people of Toledo's west end and far north end were happy to see spring come at last. But the weather of spring can be unpredictable, and Sunday, April 11, 1965, was a spring day. By early evening, the weathermen at Toledo Express Airport began to get indications that Sunday would be unpredictable. A low-pressure system moved into the central Great Lakes, and a cold front extended from it all the way into Texas. Along that front, there would be thunderstorms, hail, perhaps a tornado or two. A severe weather warning went out. But no one believes the weather will really be severe. Sunday night made believers of a great many people. For a tornado hit Toledo. The twister touched down first at Monroe, Pennsylvania, near the Notre Dame Academy. It swept across the intersection, smashing the Green Derby restaurant. It left the White Hut restaurant a shambles. Monday afternoon, April 12th, 1965. Unlike any other Monday that ever has been, hopefully unlike any Monday that ever will be. Less than 24 hours ago, this was a lovely residential area in Shoreland, one of the last remaining areas of Washington Township. Today, it is nothing, not even kindling wood. In 30 seconds last night, the homes here were destroyed, abolished, in 30 seconds. The News and Public Affairs Department of WTOL-Television presents a report on the disaster of April 11th, narrated by Channel 11 News Director Joe Gillis, and brought to you as another public service of People's Savings Association of Toledo. And then it hit the DeVoe Shopping Center and Shoppers Town. And it continued its path, crashed into the Blue Line Fuel Company. And then it lifted, soaring over the residential areas east of the Miracle Mile, missing Larchmont Gardens, but hitting again at the Glass Bowl Lane, the Telegraph and Alexis. And once more it lifted. And then it slammed into Shoreland. The police were busy in the west end from 9:30 on. North end crews were told to head over to the west. One crew in the north end said it couldn't move because of the rain. And then one police unit, 582 was its designation, was told to head north on the expressway. There had been a report of an overturned bus. One member of Unit 582 last night was Officer Art Hervey.
Art Hervey, you and your partner were in Unit 582 last night, and at about shortly before 10, the storm struck you. Where were you?
We were heading south on Huffman Road, trying to get out of the main path of the storm, and we headed for the underpass at the expressway and Huffman Road as the hail started hitting us. We were forced almost completely off the road before we could get under cover. The windshield wipers or anything wouldn't work against the force of the wind. And after we got under cover, the dispatcher was sending various crews to the interchange of Monroe Street and Sylvania, where they had heard that the Green Derby had been demolished. So our crews were all heading in that direction. They didn't know anything about the Souter Avenue and Vistamar area being hit as yet. We got out from under the underpass when the worst of the storm had passed us and were heading across Manhattan when a call came from the dispatcher to investigate a Greyhound bus being overturned on the northern leg of the expressway north of Manhattan. So we headed out that way, and before we could get anywhere within, say, a half a mile of it, we were completely blocked by traffic and had to go to the edge of the roadway. When we got up to the Souter overpass, we noticed that there were no lights at all in this housing area, the Vistamar area, and immediately called for ambulances and rushed over into that area to see what we could do for the wounded people. There were no lights at all, and The area was just demolished, utter devastation. You couldn't believe that something like that had happened. And if you hadn't known that those houses were there, it looked like an empty field.
This was about, shortly after 10. Probably this had happened maybe 15, 20 minutes before, and nobody knew about it until you got there then.
That's correct. We figured that some of these people that we found huddled under blankets and mattresses and so forth had been actually exposed to the elements, their houses demolished around them for 15 or 20 minutes before we were able to get there.
Now, I can remember hearing, I don't know whether it was you, your partner, or one of the other crews, saying that a gas line had broken. You could hear screams in the area. Was that one of you two?
Yes, my partner said to make sure that anybody that came into the area wasn't smoking or using flares because of the broken gas lines, and you could smell the odor of natural gas all over the area, and we had to watch for wires. Of course, we didn't notice any arcing wires, so we figured that the whole area was completely dead. There were no lights at all except our flashlights and our spotlight.
What could you see in that meager light?
It just looked like, it's awfully hard to describe. It looked something like a giant had swept the whole area clean, like a child's playhouse had been just crushed in by a human hand, only on a scale magnified 100 times or something of that nature. We noticed at least 12 or 15 houses completely swept off their foundations and left laying around various pieces of clothing and television sets. What once had been beautiful furniture completely destroyed, and the houses swept. Sometimes two or three houses in a row would be swept completely clean off the foundations and piled up with a huge pile of rubbish from all three or four houses into one large pile, maybe 50 to 100 yards from that particular site.
Where did you find the injured? Were they outside these buildings? Were they under the rubble?
There were some under the rubble, mostly exposed, though. These people that we found, the first ones that we found that were able to cry for help and tell us where to come to find them, were sheltered as best they could be from a small portion of a wall. I remember we found a man and wife and his two children huddled under a mattress with their night clothes on and only wet, soggy blankets wrapped around them for protection. Their house was completely leveled, and they were in a small area only sticking up 3 or 4 feet, what was left of a two-story house.
How long did it seem to you before those police ambulances got there and then later the civilian ambulances?
Oh, we called. The first time I called, I told them to send 6 or 7 ambulances, I believe. Everything was pretty hectic. I think that our first police ambulance arrived there within just a few minutes. Must have been only 4 or 5 minutes, it seemed like. And as they started coming in, we must have loaded 6 or 8 people, including stretcher cases and walking wounded, into the first 2 ambulances that got there. And as they got on their way, then some of the civilian ambulances started coming in up the highway. We could see them coming, and I would say that within a good 20 minutes or so, we had as many ambulances as we needed right there at the scene. They responded wonderfully. We couldn't ask for any better help from both our crews and all the civilian ambulances also.
How long were you out there last night?
We were released out there approximately 3:15 this morning. Our shift runs from 8 at night until 4 in the morning, so we were there. We were the first emergency crew there and one of the last ones to leave, as we did turn everything over to the sheriff's department except for an occasional check by a couple of our crews. The sheriff's department had their off-duty people called in, and civil defense. If it hadn't been for civil defense and these citizens band operators helping us out with the traffic on the expressway, it could have gotten a lot worse, because these people wanted to stop and come over into the area and look things over, and they had several citizens band and civil defense people out there on the highway keeping the traffic moving. All the emergency crews from Bedford Township, Toledo, Sylvania, I understand Oregon and Shoreland, everybody that came to the scene, the Red Cross, they just reacted wonderfully to this devastating emergency.
You never did find that bus, though, did you?
No, sir, we didn't see it at all. I understand it was in the southbound lane, and as we came north, our view was completely blocked by a double line of half-mile-long cars and trucks, which were held up by two large semis being overturned in the northbound lane. So we didn't see the bus at all. We weren't able to get to that part of it. But we left our car up on the expressway and immediately went into the disaster area rather than to worry about getting the traffic moving on the expressway. And the Michigan State Troopers and sheriff's deputies and so forth came down and helped to move the traffic and get those trucks back into the middle of the expressway.
You ever seen anything like it?
No, I'll have 12 years on this Friday, and it's the worst I've ever seen. There have been some bad ones, but I think the one in Flint about 10 years ago, where we sent a lot of emergency equipment and crews up there, was the worst before this, but I think this is just as bad or worse than that one was.
This is the bus Art Harvey and Joe Morin, his partner, were sent to find. A short ways line bus chartered by the New York Central to take some passengers from Toledo to Detroit. Four people died in this bus, four of the 13 known to have perished in last night's agonizing 30 seconds. The bus driver, Arthur Harrell of 236 Gradoff, was one of the victims. Three passengers also died, Charles Dooley of 2339 Goddard, Joseph Kokelmeyer of Buffalo, New York, Mrs. Gertrude Mann of 3430 Douglas. The bus was just one of the vehicles which overturned in those brief moments on the expressway. Eight cars and three trucks were also flipped off the roadway. In one of those cars, two men headed for a job in Detroit. Only one of them survived. When Don Edwards interviewed him at St. Vincent's Hospital last night, he didn't know his effort to save his friend had failed.
What is your name, sir?
Russell Klass.
Mr. Klass, where are you from?
Cincinnati, Ohio.
Can you tell us a little bit just what happened tonight? Where were you when this tornado struck?
I was on I-75 going to Detroit. And the wind started blowing real hard. And we pulled over and stopped. And just about that time is when the full force, I guess, of the tornado hit. And it just picked our car up. And we were on I-75. And when I woke up, we was on a street parallel to I-75. I don't know, maybe 50 or 100 feet off of the highway.
The wind just picked your car up and blew it that far.
Yeah, there was no windows or anything left in it. I couldn't even find a dry place to get. And my buddy was laying out about 20 feet from the car, and I managed to drag him up, and I stuck his head under the car, and I covered him up with what clothes I had, and that's all I could do for him, but he's in bad shape.
And then where were you found? Did you go for help?
No, the cops came there. I couldn't leave him, and there was no place to go. I mean, all the houses were gone. There was nothing there.
You were driving from Cincinnati to Detroit.
Uh-huh.
Well, thank you very, very much, Mr. Klaus.
Even as rescue workers tried to clear away the carnage on the expressway, Patrolman Art Harvey and Joe Morin were beginning to receive help here in the smashed and battered homes they had found along Souter. The story of that chaos of Vistamar and Terramar in a moment. The wreckage was almost unbelievable, and the rescue teams went to work immediately, guiding the walking wounded to ambulances, prying up the tatters of homes to find those pinned inside. The disaster was in Washington Township, but no one asked about boundary lines. Police and firemen from all over were at the scene. Coast Guardsmen came, civil defense workers, private citizens. They all helped out in the dimness of that tragic night. The injured were sent to every hospital in the area. They all went on disaster alert. And as their wounds were treated, those who had lost their homes began to tell their story.
What is your name, sir?
Earl Greiner.
Mr. Greiner, where did you live here in Toledo?
In the north end on Terramar.
And what were you doing when the storm struck?
The whole family was in bed when the tornado hit. The only thing I remember is going stare. And I was out there for a while. I don't remember too much after that.
Did you wake up in the bed or in your house? What happened?
No, I was about 30 feet from the house, and I had a part of a wall and a cedar chest in me. And the cedar chest was also in the wife's leg. I guess that's what broke that, her leg.
And your wife was injured. Do you have any children?
Yeah, I got three children. Two boys and a girl.
And I understand two.
That's right.
And how about your house? Is there very much left of it?
I was told that it was completely demolished.
Well, thank you very, very much, Mr. Driver.
Yeah.
Tom, how old are you?
13.
Can you tell me where you were when this storm hit?
In my mom and dad's bedroom.
Getting ready to go to bed, were you?
Yes.
What happened?
Well, I heard this buzzing noise, and I said, what is that? And then the house blew over, and I was buried in the woods, and it fell on my chest.
The whole house just caved right in on top of you?
Yes.
How about the rest of your family? Were any of them hurt?
Yes, my dad, my mother, my biggest sister, Marcia Ben.
And who found you?
Huh? Oh, I was laying down. Mr. DeBoer, She was the one that picked me up and took him down there to his house. So then the police car team got me, got me halfway down. Then a man picked me up and took me the rest of the way down.
Did you see any black funnel that's usually associated with tornadoes?
No.
Just heard that big wind, is that it?
Yes.
Well, thanks a lot, young fella.
You're welcome.
What is your name, please?
Dr. Rutter.
Doctor, where were you when this storm hit your home?
In the front room of my house. I've been listening to the warnings on the radio, and they said that there was a tornado alert possible from 6 o'clock to 11 o'clock, and my friends are visiting me, and about 9:30 they were going to go home because the storm was picking up a little bit, but then it picked up a little bit too much, and before they could get out of the house, the thing hit with a cannon and demolished the house and shook us up a little bit and banged us up a little bit.
Did you hear anything before it hit, any big sound, or did you see any black funnel?
I didn't see anything. We were inside the house, as I said, and I just see the front wall of the house coming at me, of course, when it let loose, but nothing outside. And as far as noise was concerned, we heard a roar. Everything was roaring, it seemed like, and the rain was coming down pretty good.
How about the rest of your family? Are they all right?
Yes, they're all right. My one boy was bruised a little bit, but my wife and the other boy are fine.
And your house and your automobiles, how are they?
I think they're demolished. The house is gone, I'm sure, and I expect both my cars are shot in the garage.
Well, thank you very, very much, Doctor.
Before the night was over, 169 persons would be treated in the emergency rooms, in the corridors, even in the offices of Toledo's 9 General Hospital. Riverside received the most, 47 hurt there and 5 dead on arrival, but all would do their share. Slowly, the hurts were eased. Tonight, 76 persons are still hospitalized, many of them in critical condition. The hospitals went outside their doors to help. One member of the external disaster team at Riverside talked to reporter Don Edwards.
What is your name, please?
Gail York.
Miss York, what's your capacity here in the hospital?
I'm an instructor in the School of Nursing. I supervise the students clinically and teach them in the classroom.
I understand you were one of the first nurses on the scene of the disaster. Is that right?
Yes, I'm a member of the external disaster team here at Riverside Hospital.
Well, when you got the call and went out to the scene, what did you see when you got out there?
Well, we saw, first of all, the raised houses and also crowds of people who were mobbing to the scene. That made it almost impossible for any rescuers to get through.
What did it look like to you when you got there, the destruction?
It looks as if someone had taken a razor blade and just scraped the houses right off the foundations of the earth. This is all I can say.
You've been on duty here at the hospital most of the night, I understand.
Yes, I've been here since about 9:30.
Can you tell us a little bit of what it's been like?
Well, it's been, it's quieting down now, actually. The earlier part of the evening, as you might well imagine, was chaos when they were coming in carloads of 5 and 6 ambulances.
Do you know how many you've treated so far?
I've assisted with about 10 since we've been back. You know, 10 patients and helping the students between intensive care and recovery room.
And it looks like you're going to be on duty all night long.
Oh, yeah, I expect so. We're right in here tomorrow morning, too, in case they need us.
Thank you very, very much, Mr.
Truly, thank you.
The long night ended, but the gray light of dawn would hide nothing. The full extent of the disaster would be shown. 100 homes perhaps leveled, scores of business places damaged, unbelievable wreckage. And the people would come back to pick up the pieces. Pieces were all that were left in too many cases. In the Lost Peninsula of Michigan, where Wolverine and Buckeye state authorities had worked side by side in the night, a family sifts through the wreckage of a home in which a woman was killed. 2 Lost Peninsula residents lost their lives, Mrs. Ralph Lashaway of 6367 Edgewater and Mrs. Lillian Balk of 6335 Edgewater. But the worst death toll came in the Fuller Creekside edition on Vistamar and Terramar. In the blasted remains of these homes, 5 bodies were found. Those of Mrs. Mary Moran and Percy Warren, both of Harrisonburg, Virginia, of Mrs. Shirley Smith, of Mrs. Doris Karstrom, and her son, Donald Florin. The 13th body, that of James Nye, was found in the ruins of his home on Summer. It had all happened in a mere 30 seconds, but it would take weeks to clean up the damage. The story of the effort to rebuild the North End in a moment. The dawn of April 12th brought the full horror of the night of April 11th. It also brought some hope. Man is quick to recover from the ravages nature can inflict upon him, and the people of North Toledo are men. With quiet determination, they went to work to find what had not been damaged, to plan to replace what had been. And they would not be alone. This morning brought Governor Rhodes, already declaring the devastated section a disaster area, quickly promising aid. First, National Guardsmen to protect against looting. The 2nd Brigade of the National Guard of Ohio is already on duty. And then monetary aid to help rebuild. The governor's concern is not only with Toledo, though this area was as hard hit as that in any part of the state. In all, 64 persons died in Ohio. The property damage is still uncounted, even this area, where it will run over $500,000. To Governor Rhodes, the damage here was bad, very bad. To city officials like Manager Frank Backstrom, it was a challenge.
We can do immediately for these people.
Well, of course, Red Cross funds are immediately available as far as housing and emergency food. And I'm sure that funds are available for rebuilding for those families who do not have insurance. The governor declares these areas disaster areas. There are federal programs which are available, relief programs, and I'm sure that the governor will declare an emergency situation. I understand that the mayor has talked to Congressman Ashley, and he is assembling information of possible programs that can be helpful.
How soon can they get something? Which agency?
Well, Red Cross would act first. I would say that they have...
Does business take a long time?
No, it moves pretty fast, but there's some qualifications that have to be declared disaster area before it can be officially entered into.
What about the state in the meantime?
The state, the governor indicated that the funds would be available at the state level, too.
And what can you do about the entire large area? I mean, can you provide, does this include provision of immediate housing for these people?
Yes, temporary housing and temporary funds, and then helping the family to rehabilitate and relocate.
Thank you.
As you probably realize, I've been through this in Kansas and Missouri before. I've been through three of these. And this follows pretty much the same pattern of what happens in an area when these tornadoes start dropping down.
As Governor Rhodes and his party toured the devastated North End this morning, the wheels were already turning to funnel aid to those who desperately need it. Agencies like the Red Cross and the Salvation Army provided food. The Red Cross set up temporary housing, is calling in a special disaster team. The Salvation Army provides clothing from its centers on Moorish and Erie. Churches in the area are extending their helping hand. And from Washington this evening, word from Congressman Ashley of the types of federal help available. Small Business Administration officials will be on hand tomorrow to survey damage and to report on the need for low-interest loans for commercial interest. The Farmers Home Administration can do the same for private residents. The Office of Economic Planning is standing by to assist governmental units to replace public facilities. The North End will not be alone in its tragedy. That tragedy is felt by all of us. It has been said that news is conflict, the conflict of man against man against himself, man against nature. Nature and man fought last night in Toledo. In 30 seconds, an eternity of pain was felt. It was our job to report that conflict. As reporters, we were proud to perform that duty. As Toledoans, we were and ever will be sad to have had to have told the story.
You've been watching 30 Seconds to Eternity, the story of disaster of April 11th. Brought to you as another public service by People's Savings Association of Toledo and prepared by the News and Public Affairs Department of WTOL Television under the supervision of Channel 11 News Director Joe Gillis. Photographers were Paul Hatcher, Chuck Kruger, Bruce McLaughlin, Al Van Tassel, and Joe Gillis. Reporting beside these men was Linda Hipp, Art Edgerton, George Hoffman, Gordon Ward, Ted Reams, and Don Edwards. Film editors were Art Michaud and Bob Gagnon. The program was directed by Dave Eberhard.